What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. Here I am to worship, light of the world. Light of the world, you step down into the darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, you're so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Father, when we look at that, Lord, the worship that we bring you in return, Lord, is so small, Lord. It's like it's nothing, Lord, and yet we know that you have given us this gift, Lord, to be able to worship you, Lord, to lift up our praise to you, and Lord, it is a gift to us, dear Lord, to be able to worship you, to be able to stand before you, Lord, and sing to you, Lord, in a way that honors you and in the way that you receive our worship, Father. So we praise you for that, Lord. I pray that we would be faithful in it. Lord, I pray that you would speak to our hearts through your word tonight, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. If you got your Bibles, make your way to Psalm 25, 25th chapter of the book of Psalms. I told you this morning that I was planning on preaching from the book of Psalms this morning. Lord just kind of moved me into a different area, so maybe he meant for this to be preached tonight. I hope so, because that's where we're going to be. Psalm 25, your faithful love. It is the text that I wanted to preach from this morning. God said no, preach from an old text. Somebody texted me this afternoon and told me when I preached that last. I don't remember what she said. Miss Diane, when was it? When was it? She's got it. It was
July 16th.
July the 16th of 16, wasn't it? Yeah, 16. I don't think that's the last time I preached. I think that's the first time I preached. I think the last time was in this building somewhere in the beginning of when we first got in here. But regardless of all of that, it was preached again today. So I just texted her back and I said, thank you. She never replied to that, so thank you for that. Dr. R.G. Lee, who was a pastor of Bellevue before Dr. Rogers was there, he said that if a sermon wasn't good enough to preach twice, it wasn't good enough to preach once. To that, I say amen. It was a good morning. God bless this morning, and so hopefully he will once again tonight. We're going to talk about his faithful love. Look there in verse 1 of chapter 25 of the book of Psalms. Here's what he says. Lord, I turn to you. That's point number one, turning to him. Turning to him. The psalmist David knows of whence his help comes, right? He knows that his help comes from the Lord. And he knows when he's going through hard times, which is exactly what he's talking about in Psalm 25, that his help is to the Lord. So many times, I don't know about you, it's probably just me, but so many times in my own life, I have a tendency to turn other directions other than turning toward the Lord. In Psalm 121, verses 1 through 8, the psalmist writes here and says, I lift my eyes toward the mountains. Where will my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to slip. Your protector will not slumber. Indeed, the protector of Israel does not slumber or sleep. The Lord protects you. The Lord is a shelter right by your side. The sun will not strike you by day or the moon by night. The Lord will protect you from all harm. He will protect your life. The Lord will protect your coming and going, both now and forever. Psalmist David writes, and he begins Psalm 25 by saying, Lord, I turn to you. Notice he doesn't say, Lord, you turn to me. He says, I turn to you. When you're talking to people outside of God's will, you're talking to people outside of knowing Christ as Lord and Savior, and you talk to them about this idea that you have to make a decision. That's not you waiting on God. God has done the work. We know that, right? When God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, he has done the work, but we must turn to him. And it's not just at the moment of salvation. We have to turn to him in everyday life. Every day, we have to turn to him. So that's point number one. Point number two is this, trusting in him. Trusting in him. If you look there in verses 2 through 7, he says, my God, I trust in you. Do not let me be disgraced. Do not let my enemies gloat over me. No one who waits for you will be disgraced. Those who act treacherously without cause will be disgraced. Make your ways known to me, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. I wait for you all day long. Remember, Lord, your compassion and your faithful love, for they have existed from antiquity. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my acts of rebellion. In keeping with your faithful love, remember me. Not because of what I've done, but he ended by saying, because of your goodness, Lord. Talked a little bit about this morning, but it's in the notes, so I'm going to bring it up tonight too. In 2020 is going to be a different year for Westside First Baptist Church. We're going to have some tests of faith in 2020. That's going to be a part of life in this year. Some tests are going to be financially, and who knows what else, right? I mean, we're going to have some tests of faith here at Westside. It's a wonderful thing to say the word of the year is faith, right? That's a wonderful thing because that's what everything that we have is built on faith. It's also a terrifying thing to say that the word of the year is going to be faith. But what does that mean? We're going to have to live by faith and not by sight. I don't know about you, but I like living by sight better than living by faith most days of my life. I said it this morning. I mean, I want to know what's coming up before it happens. I don't want to be surprised. I want to know. I don't like just living by faith thing where I don't know what's out there. I don't like the unknown. I just don't like the unknown. That's what it means to live by faith. At Westside, I think in 2020 we're going to have to practice faith like probably we never practiced it before. Not just in a corporate setting as a church, but in our individual lives as well. You know, there are people in our church, people that maybe are here tonight, certainly people who are here on Sunday morning, and they're trusting and they're living by faith. Faith is not just an issue in their life that they come to on Sundays, but faith is an everyday thing. There's some who are having to practice faith financially. There's some who have to practice faith in physical health. Now, finances are one thing. Physical health is a whole other ballgame. It's a whole other level. By the way, I want you to pray for the pastor and for his wife and his little girl. I think her name is Gianna. Is that right? Genevieve. He's the pastor at Mount Vernon. I guess it's the First Baptist Church, Mount Vernon. It's the Baptist church that you turn in towards the ball, towards the school there. They always have all of those buses lined up for those of you who go to ball games over there. His daughter was diagnosed a couple weeks ago with cancer. She is seven, young girl. He put on Facebook the other day, I didn't know him, I don't know him, but I found out that his daughter had cancer. I sent him a message on Facebook, said, I'm praying for you, you know, if there's anything we can do, post by, can be there a few minutes, whatever you need, you know, we'll do it. And he put on Facebook the other day that he thought he had cried more that day than he had ever cried in his life. He was holding his little girl. And y'all, you know, when we talk about money, and we talk about issues and buildings and all that, but, oh, my cancer in a seven-year-old. Oh, the ballgame. And some of you are having to practice faith with your own physical health. Excuse me. Hopefully, prayerfully, not with a seven-year-old, but practicing faith with physical health and physical needs. Not just physical health, not just financial health, but job situation, outcome, your children's lives, having to turn them over to the Lord. All those things are involved in what it means to live by faith. The psalmist says in his writing here in verse 5, he says, guide me in your truth. He asked God to teach him. He says, for you are the God of my salvation. Listen to what he says in the latter part of verse 5. He says, I wait for you all day long. I don't like that. I wish he wouldn't even put that there. Because that reminds me that in my daily life, I am called and must stop and wait on him. I don't like waiting. I don't like waiting at the checkout line at Walmart. I don't like waiting whenever I pull up to a stoplight. I don't like waiting when I have to wait on God. I don't like it. I don't like it. I like for God to be one step ahead of me and me just following right behind. I don't want to have to stop and wait. Now listen, I don't mean wait on God to catch up. I don't mean that. But I don't like having to wait on God to work out whatever it is that I'm going through. Psalmist says, I wait on him all day. The illustration, the idea is that he is willing to wait until God moves. He is willing to wait until God decides that it is time to move. You know, Sarah, we just talked about the service this morning. It was a good service. We enjoyed it. It was a blessing. We had two or three guys walk out that I'd never seen before and talked about the service, and it was a good service. You know, and that's the way it is when God moves. When God moves in a service, that's what it's like. It's good. It's emotional. I'm not saying the service is built on emotion, it's built on truth, but emotions go with it. People walk out saying, man, that was good. Not always that way at our church on a Sunday morning. Boy, it's good when it is, isn't it? Waiting on the Lord to move, waiting on the Lord to move in our lives and in our church. Psalm 21 and verse 5 says, the plans of the diligent lead to profit, but anyone who is reckless certainly becomes poor. I'm going to read that one more time. It's a good proverb. He says, The plans of the diligent certainly lead to profit, but anyone who is reckless certainly becomes poor. Planning, waiting are just a part of the Christian life. And the psalmist knows it and writes, and says, I wait for you. Why? Because of your compassion, he says in verse 6, your faithful love, for they have existed from antiquity. What does he mean from antiquity? From everlasting. They've always been. Our God is not a new age God. He's not an old age God. He is the God of now. He is the God of the yesterday. And he is the God, certainly, of the tomorrow. He says, you and your faithfulness have existed forever. And then he says in verse 7, odd verse. He says, do not remember the sins of my youth or my acts of rebellion. Can I get a witness? Amen, David, I'm with you. Things in my younger life, Lord, I wish you would remember. I wish you would never bring those up again. Let's move on past that. And good news is, if we have repented of it, he has moved past it, and so should we. Amen? We don't have to think about those things. We have laid them before the throne of God and before the throne of the grace of Christ, and they have been separated as far as the east is from the west. We are certainly forgiven. David doesn't call upon the name of God because of David's faithfulness. David calls upon the name of God because of God's faithfulness. He appeals to his character trait of faithfulness. And he says, I'm not calling on you because of who I am. As a matter of fact, he is reminded when he does call upon him of his own sins and of his own acts of rebellion. He says, don't remember all of those things in keeping with your faithful love. He says, remember me. Why? Because of your goodness. Missionary statesman Hudson Taylor had complete trust in God's faithfulness. You can read about it in his life and the life that he did live in a very well way with walking with Christ. In his journal, he wrote, our Heavenly Father is a very experienced one. He knows very well that his children wake up with a good appetite every morning. He sustained 3 million Israelites in the wilderness for 40 years. We do not expect he will send 3 million missionaries to China, but if he did, he would have an ample means to sustain them all. Depend on us. God's work done in God's way will never lack God's supply. It's a great quote, isn't it? God's work done in God's way will never lack God's supply. He will sustain it. He said, well, how do you work God's way? Question, isn't it? Good question. How do you do things God's way? I don't know all the questions you ought to ask yourself before you do anything. You want to do it God's way. But I believe, number one, you ought to ask yourself, can I glorify Christ in this? And you fill in the blank. If you're going, you know, we got young people here tonight. Some are about to get out of high school. One of them being my son. A year and another year and a half or so, he'll be gone. Hallelujah. I mean, he'll be gone. And he'll be going to college. So that's his plan right now. You know, he's 16. It could change tomorrow. You know how that is. But we got young people going to make decisions with their life. What are they going to go to school for? What kind of job are they going to get when they get out of school? And the question is, can I glorify Christ with that? You say, well, I'm not going to be a preacher. I'm not asking you to be a preacher. I'm asking you to be whatever God's called you to be. But if you are going to do something, can I glorify God with what I'm going to do? In other words, if you're going to be a plumber to the glory of God. If you're going to be an electrician to the glory of God. If you're going to be a school teacher, be a school teacher to the glory of God. Now, in our lives, we make decisions every day. Sometimes we hit the mark. Sometimes we miss the mark. I will assure you, every time we miss the mark, we cannot glorify Christ with that. Psalm 117 says this. It's one of the shorter psalms. It's only two verses. Praise the Lord, all nations. Glorify him, all peoples. Why? For his faithful love to us is great. The Lord's faithfulness endures forever. And the psalmist ended with hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord. His faithfulness endures forever. So, turning to him, the psalmist understands that I must turn to him and trusting in him, walking with him every day of our lives. Why? Because he is good. And then point number three is trusting because of him. Trusting because of him. You can read it there in verses 8 and following. It says, the Lord is good and upright. Therefore, he shows sinners the way. The Lord is good and upright. Therefore, he shows us the way. Not because of who we are. Amen. It's a truth over and over and over in God's word. It's not because of who we are, but it's because of who he is. He shows us the way because he is good and because he is upright. He leads the humble in the way that, in what is right, and teaches them his way. All the Lord's ways show faithful love and truth to those who keep his covenant and decrees. Because of your name, Yahweh, forgive my sin, for it is great. He was reminded again as he thinks and as he meditates and as he writes about the greatness of God and about the faithfulness of God and about the goodness of God. And when he writes in verse 8, the Lord is good and upright, that word upright means he's straight. He's straight as an arrow. He'll never do what is wrong. And when he thinks about the goodness of God and he sees himself in the eyes of God, he has to repent. He has to repent. He says, Yahweh, forgive my sin. Why? Because it is great. Because he understood that he was a sinner. This idea of being upright, this idea of being straight, this idea of being holy, this idea of being righteous. Aren't you glad that this righteousness, holy God, shows sinners the right way? If he didn't, we wouldn't have a clue. The people in our culture today who believe that there is no God, if they have a moral right and a moral wrong, just having a moral right and a moral wrong, how do we get that? From God. How do we know we ought not kill one another? He told us. He told us. Thou shalt not murder. It's wrong. Why is it wrong? Is it wrong if someone's done harm to me? Yeah, that's wrong. That's why we have a court in the land and we take them to court and we do the right way. It's broken, I understand. But that's the reason we have government, right? God set this thing up. It wasn't just haphazardly. It wasn't just a few men who got together one day and said, you know what, we're going to make up some rules. And we're just going to figure out what's right and what's wrong. You know, it's wrong for you to go after your neighbor's wife. How do we know that that's wrong? You see, culture today, in a lot of ways, tells us that if it feels good, do it. There's no absolute truth, but we know that there's absolute truth. Why? Because we know there is a God in heaven. And he's told us what absolute truth is, certainly found according to his word. He's taught sinners the way. Deuteronomy chapter 4, beginning in verse 1, God writes to Israel, he says, now Israel, listen to the statutes and ordinances I am teaching you to follow, so that you may live, enter, and take possession of the land Yahweh, the God of your father, has given you. You must not add anything to what I command you, or you must not take away from it, so that you may keep the commands of the Lord your God I am giving you. Your eyes have seen what the Lord did at Baal Peor, for the Lord your God destroyed every one of you. For the Lord your God destroyed every one of you who followed Baal and Peor. But you have remained faithful to the Lord your God and are all alive today. Look, I have taught you statutes and ordinances as the Lord my God commanded me, so that you may follow them in the land you are entering to possess. Carefully follow them, for this will show your wisdom and understanding in the eyes of the people. When they hear about all the statutes, they will say, this great nation is indeed a wise and understanding people. For what a great nation is there that has a God near to it as the Lord our God is to us whenever we call on him? And what great nation has righteous statutes and ordinances like the entire law I set before you today? Only be on your guard and diligently watch yourself so that you don't forget the things your eyes have seen, and so that you don't slip, they don't slip from your mind as long as you live. Teach them to your children and your grandchildren, The day you stood before the Lord your God in Horeb, the Lord said to me, assemble the people before me, and I will let them hear my words, so that they may learn to fear me all the days of they live on the earth, and may instruct their children. You came near to the base of the mountain, a mountain blazing with fire, into the heavens and enveloped in a dense black cloud. And the Lord spoke to you from the fire. You kept hearing the sound of words, but you didn't see a form. There was only a voice. He declared his covenant to you. He commanded you to follow the Ten Commandments, which he wrote on two stone tablets. At the time, the Lord commanded me to teach you statutes and ordinances for you to follow in the land you are about to cross into and possess. What's the meaning? Meaning is obedience to God's word. The psalmist writes in Psalm 25, Lord, show me your faithful love in verse 10 and truth. To those who keep his covenant and decrees, because of your name, Yahweh, forgive my sin, for it is great. Who is the man who fears the Lord? In verse 12. He will show him the way. He should choose, and he will give a good life, and his descendants will inherit the land. The counsel of the Lord is for those who fear him, and he reveals his covenant to them. My eyes are always on the Lord, for he will pull my feet out of the net. Talks about obedience, and then he talks about going through these dark times. Billy Graham talked about, as did others, the dark nights of the soul, going through hard times of depression, even in the Christian life, even in following Christ. And you'll face those times. You'll face those times when you don't know what to do. You'll face those times where you make a decision that you think is based on God's word. You think it's the right thing, and when you have made the decision, you may realize, I have messed up in a bad place. And so what do you do when you go through those hard times of danger? He says, put your eyes on the Lord in verse 15. He'll pull your feet out of the net. What is this net that he talks about? He's talking about a trap. He's talking about harm that could come. Keep your eyes on the Lord. Verse 16, he talks about loneliness. He says, turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am alone and afflicted. You ever felt like that? You ever felt like nobody else was there? David, in his own life, not only did he lose many of his friends and many of his followers at times throughout his reign, but he lost three sons, Absalom, Amnon, and Adonijah. They all turned against him. And so did a very close friend and counselor. David knew what it was like to be alone. He knew what it was like to have no one else to turn to except God. And sometimes God puts us in situations where we feel all alone. I don't know that we ever really are necessarily completely alone. As we go through this life, I hope you're not. If you're a member at Westside, I hope there's always someone around you who would be there for you. But there's so many times in our own lives where we feel alone. There's so many times that we are going through situations of loneliness that we feel alone even when we're surrounded by the crowd. You go through those times of loneliness. When you go through those times of being all by yourself, what do? He talks in verse 1. Turn to him. Turn to him. You know, our Lord is the Lord who has promised never to leave us and never to forsake us. You know what that word never means in Greek, Hebrew, and Aramaic? Look it up. It means never. Most of the instances where he says that, it's this double negative where he says never, never, no, not ever. He wants you to know that when I say never, I really mean never. Now, I may tell you I will never leave you nor forsake you, but in this flesh, I probably will at some point, right? You may tell me, Brother Doug, I'm with you, man. I've had people do that, and then a few years later, you look back, and they left the church. A lot of times, they left the church because they're angry about something that you supposedly did. It happens, right? And you look back and go, I thought you'd never leave. I thought you were, man, I'm in it. I'm so excited. People leave. Friends fade away. Family die and go to heaven if they know Jesus. It happens. It's part of life. Not the fun part, not the easy part, but it happens. But our God, He doesn't sleep nor slumber. The God of Israel is the God of your life, if you know His Son Jesus, right? He'll never leave you, He'll never forsake you. You may feel alone, but you are certainly not alone. He talks about a broken heart in verse 17. He says, the distresses of my heart increase. He says, bring me out of my sufferings. What's he talking about? He's talking about depression. He's talking about going through a hard time. He's talking about a time of loneliness. He talks about regrets in verse 18. He says, consider my affliction and trouble. Take away all my sin. By the way, it's the third time he said that in this chapter. You think David had some regrets? I just do this. Absolutely, David had some regrets. You can read about some of his regrets in the Word of God. That's one of the good things about the Word of God. The Word of God just doesn't sugarcoat it to make it sound good. It tells you the good and the bad. It's one of the ways that you know that the Word of God is true. Because why in the world would the disciples in the New Testament write about their shortcomings? They wouldn't if not inspired by a holy God. Right? I mean, I'm not going to tell you about all my shortcomings. I'm not going to tell you about all my failures. If I'm going to write a biography of my life, I'm not going to tell you about the hard times. I'm going to talk about the good stuff. This Bible is very true and very sincere and very open and very transparent with every person that it writes about. And God is very sincere when He writes in His Word about His people. He writes about their good times. He writes about their bad times. He writes about the times that they're in danger and they didn't do one thing to deserve it. And he writes about those times when the Babylonians come and they overtake. And you can read that in your Old Testament. As a matter of fact, the vast majority of your Old Testament is written about God's people failing, God's people falling short, and of course, the long arm of our God reaching down to pick them back up. But sometimes they have to go through some hard times. They have to have some broken hearts. They have to go into danger. They have to have some loneliness to get them where they need to be. In verses 19 and 20 of chapter 25, he talks about fear. He said, consider my enemies. He's already talked about this in chapter 25. Consider my enemies. They are numerous. They hate me violently. They want to kill me. That's what he said. They hate me violently. He says, guard me and deliver me. Do not let me be put to shame, for I take refuge in you. Talked about it a little bit this morning. Well, fear is liar. We don't have anything to fear when we know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and we're living in His will. Nothing to fear. What can man do to us? Absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. You say, well, what happens if they come against us? The Bible says that even in the presence of our enemies, the Lord has a table prepared for us. We don't have to stumble and fall. Psalm 27 tells us we don't have to stumble and fall. We keep our eyes on Him. And what does He do? When all of earth, hell is breaking loose in our lives, keep our eyes focused on Him. Sit at His table. We eat and we feast on the Word. The Word. So He talks about fear. He talks about despair. In verse 21, He says, may integrity and what is right watch over me, for I wait for you. He says in verse 22, God, redeem Israel from all its distresses. Israel was certainly a nation that had distress. Israel was certainly a nation that had times where they needed the Lord to step in on their behalf. Israel was a nation that had moments where they followed God, but they were short and sweet. The majority of the time, the Israelite nation would turn away. And Psalmist David here writes, God redeemed Israel from its distresses. If you look up this chapter, chronologically in the Word of God and where it was written. You know, there are some chapters that we know what was going on in David's life, like Psalm 51. And in Psalm 51, David writes, and he begs God's forgiveness. Why? Because he's been caught in the act of adultery with Bathsheba, murder, lying, you name it. David pretty much did it during that time. And the whole chapter is a chapter of repentance. So we know what happened before, and we know why he would write that chapter. We don't know exactly where this chapter lines up historically. No. Don't know. Most biblical scholars will put Psalm 25 somewhere towards the end of David's life. You know, it's easy to say that, you know, maybe this is when he was running from Saul, but he wasn't an old man when that took place. Most scholars put this towards the latter years of David. You know what that tells me? That tells me there's no age limit on fear, no age limit on despair, that there's no age limit on depression, there's no age limit on feeling like I'm all alone. No age limit. No. There's no point in time where you get to the point where you have arrived until you get to heaven. You know, I used to think it was funny. When I first got into ministry, I felt like most young people do. I felt like, you know, if I could just reach to be the age of, and then you fill in the blank, everything would be fine. I'd have it all together when I get to be their age. I won't deal with temptation in the same way when I get to be that age, whatever that age is. It keeps growing. The older I get, the older I think I need to be to have it all figured out, right? And then I got into the pastorate. I left youth ministry. I was only in youth ministry about a year and a half. I left youth ministry and being an associate pastor. You know what an associate pastor is? He's the guy that you ask, and if he can't answer, that's okay. But the pastor is the guy you ask, and he better find an answer. He better figure it out. So I left the associate pastor where I could get some questions and say, I don't know, you need to ask. He's smart. Left that and became a pastor. A couple years after becoming a pastor, I realized old folks don't have it all figured out either. Shoot, man, none of us have this thing figured out, right? You know what I realized? I realized we're all struggling in different ways. Some days are better than others. Don't get me wrong. God bless you. Well, we all have our issues. We all have our things. We all have our points of contention. We all have those things that I believe Satan knows very well where we can be weak. Not all of them are saints. Some guys are a little more tempted with pornography than others. Some guys are a little more tempted with being unfaithful, their wives and others. Some people a little more tempted to gossip than others. Some people are a little more tempted to jump too quick than others. On and on and on we can go, right? I don't know where you are. I don't know what you're thinking. I don't. But I know this, there's someone to the right, to the left of you who's struggling with you. You may be here tonight and say, well, I'm not struggling too much. I'm doing pretty good right now. Well, just wait. Just wait. You're either in a problem, coming out of a problem, or I got bad news. You're heading into one, right? We live in a sinful, fallen, broken world. You can be Republican, you can be Democrat, but it won't fix the fact that we live in a sinful, fallen world. You can be pro-Trump or anti-Trump, but it doesn't change the fact. You can be Baptist or you can be Methodist, it doesn't change the fact. We live in a sinful and a broken world. This is not our roadmap to life. This is not. This is our lifeline to heaven. And God didn't write the 10 suggestions. Right? What he said in his word is what he wants us to live. How do you have a blessed life? Be obedient. Just be obedient. When? Sunday. We'll talk about Monday tomorrow. be obedient today. And some of you know what I'm talking about very well. That's where you're living. And we all should. You get to a point of despair, that's how you live from day to day. Or get you through the day. You don't look at a budget for the month, you look at the budget for the day. Look at the budget for the week. We don't look at what we're going to eat for dinner on Friday night. I just want to know, Lord, can I make it through Sunday? Some of you may be at the point where it's not just make it through Sunday, but Lord, get me to church. And Lord, after church, I'll go home. And after I get home, Lord, I'll eat something. And after that, Lord, just get me through moment by moment. Not everybody knows what I'm talking about, but some of you do. Some of you are going through some hard times. We've all been there. Who is the hope for it all? Our Jehovah Jireh. The one that we run to. Our very present help in our time of need. The psalmist begins the same place we began. The same place I want to end tonight. Instead, Lord, I turn to you. I don't know what you're going through, but I know we serve a God that you can turn to. I know we serve a God that is not just good, but he is faithful. He's not faithful like I'm faithful. I'm faithful most of the time. He's faithful all the time. I don't know what your need is in life tonight, but I do know this. He can. He will supply. I don't know where you are in life, but I do know this. He blesses faithfulness. He blesses obedience. I also know that there's nothing you can do to make him love you more. There's nothing you can do to make him love you less. He loves you. He loves you. Psalm 25. It's a song of desperation. But it's a song of great hope. He is here. And the book of James in the New Testament tells us, and goes a little further into the process, that when we reach out to him, he reaches right back down to us. So I don't know where you are in life, but I know this, he is good, he is here, and he is able. Let's bow our heads for prayer. So Paul can come and lead us in time of invitation. Now, I don't know if we do this, and very rarely do this on a Sunday night. I just wonder, nobody looking around, just me and God. I just wonder, because I know there's more than one, but maybe somebody here tonight would say, Preacher, I need God right now in my life like I've never needed him before. I'm hungry and I'm desperate. Anybody here like that? Just go put your hand through. Amen. Anybody else? Yeah. Hands go up all over the room. They always do. I wonder if somebody here might ask you to slip up your hand or anything like that. But you're going through a time where you've never been before. Time of great need, a time where you need God to lean on you. I don't know where you are, but I know he is here. And I know that he is able. We're not called to figure this thing out. We're called to trust him and to walk day by day. So just a little encouragement before invitation time. You can trust him. People will fail you. Denominations will fail you. Preachers will fail you. But God and his word will never fail. We don't have a time of invitation. You're here tonight. God will move you to come forward. Come forward with you. I'd love to sit down and talk with you. Maybe you need to come and kneel in the altar of prayer. You do that. They're open. Whatever God would have you do, I just pray you'd be obedient. Father, we love you. Father, I ask that you'd move you in this invitation. Lord, I'm done. I'm out of play. Lord, you move and work in this place. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your presence. Lord, we can't live in this morning tonight. Lord, we need you. Lord, I ask you to move from this place tonight. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's all stand. You need to come. You come.
Take my life, leave me alone. Take my life, leave me alone.
This week, everything gets back to normal. We've got Bible studies and all that going on this week. Wednesday night, kids will be here. By the dozens, they'll be here. So all that's going on. I think we got college kids going back to college this week. Y'all all go back. Everything getting back to normal this week. So I don't know about you, I'm kind of ready. I've had enough of the off time. Now those of you who are, you know, retired, every day is a holiday. I understand. The only way you know days are different is Sunday and the doctor appointment. So I don't know what y'all do. For the rest of us, I'm ready to get back to normal. So anyway, all that's going on this week, you know everything that we do. Thank you for coming back on a Sunday night. Could stay at home, could be watching football right now or something. I don't know what other people watch, but I'd be watching by the home. But thank you for coming back. I don't have anything we got tonight. We've got a good crowd. Blessing to see that. All right. Is there anything needs to be announced? Yes, sir. Yeah. Never join the military. Well, don't worry. I'm too old now to join the military. So that's all going to work out. Junior, will you dismiss us in a word of prayer, please?
Yeah, she's...